Ladies and gentlemen, tonight we're having a programme of total rubbish. Yes. Where do we begin? Let's see. Shall we start with the end of Croydon. Croydon. There's a lousy place for pubs. My first digs were in Croydon, and there were about seven other guys who used to eat round the same table every night. And they would, after we, you know, they'd have all sorts of weird jobs, and I just got a job as a cartoonist, my first job. And my first digs were in Croydon with Mrs. Green. And Mrs. Green used to feed us every night, you know, give us some awful, bloody, terrible. But it was good. And then it was my cousin, actually, Alec, who lived over Wanstead way in Essex, and said, "Would you like us to find you a better landlady?" I was going to do a book on landladies once, and I thought it would have been a good thing, and I think it turned into a book of dogs, actually. It turned into a book called Dog's Bodies.
Ralph, yeah. It is magnificent to have you with us. I guess what people are probably going to want to know about, not just your first landlady, but how did you feel when you were approached to have a film made about your extraordinary career and your life in many ways?
Oh, God, not another one, I said. And so I thought, no, it was not. It was just Charlie's persistence coming down. The 1 month he'd say, "I'd like to come down today, could come and film you in the studio." And then that became a more regular sort of thing until over 15 years or something, so I'm told. I think somebody's stolen 20 years of my life, someone, and I'm wondering whether they're in this room. Who knows? And maybe on the bookshelves. And I think it became something that, well, I guess we had to finish it, you know. That's how it became. And to have it done in this rather starry fashion, it's quite nice. You know, think, oh, blimey. People noticed something, you know, that I had been doing all these drawings all these years, and people have been pinching them. You know, I know people have pinched a lot of stuff, and I've lost a lot of stuff. I've sold my originals that I ever did with Hunter Thompson to Rolling Stone magazine, as a good career move. How about that? Somebody told me, you know.
What made Hunter such a rare and dangerous individual?
Provocation. Simple provocation. You know, he realized when we've met that, first of all, we said we'd meet at the Kentucky Derby. We call it Derby, you know, not Derby, by the way. And I was looking for him for 3 days, or 2 days, sorry, don't exaggerate. 2 days, still looking for him somewhere in Kentucky. We said we'd meet here. And he, I heard this, excuse me. Yes? Oh, hello, are you Ralph Stone? Yes. The artist Ming? Yes. Okay. I was supposed to meet and do something together. I said, yes. He said, shall we take a beer first? I said, okay. So we sat down with a beer. And then he said, do you bet? And I said, well, I did once bet on the Grand National back in 1954, and it was early mist. And so I see. You never bet before, no, since? I said, no. He said, well, anyway, just choose a horse and say if it's going to come in or not. So I picked one, you know. It wasn't Dust Commander, but it was one like it, because Dust Commander won the actual Derby. And I said, I'll have that one. So they ran, and it won. So, hey, you're pretty good at this. Why don't you have a go at betting properly? Put a dollar on something. So I put a dollar on some horse or other, I don't know which one, and it lost. And he said, oh. I said, that's why I don't bet. Because if I bet something, it usually inevitably wins. You know, if I put some couple of quid on something, it'll lose. You know, it'll, yeah, if I actually put the money out. But if I don't put anything on it, I just pick one, it usually wins. It's best that way. And so I'm never going to be a gambler.
How much of a transformative effect did that first taste of Gonzo and of America have on you as an artist?
I think he said he'd never met anyone quite as weird, but I'm not weird. He's weird, but he made me weird. You know, the way when we met, we recognized a sort of a spontaneous need to get crazy. And to get crazy was what we needed. We had to become the story. You couldn't just be somebody writing timidly about the story that you were going to cover. You didn't go there for that. You became the story. It was the only way to go. And that's what he sort of taught me, and I kind of reflected it in the drawings, which were as crazy as I could think of at the time. You know, I have done crazier things, but somehow sometimes I get too crazy. I don't know.
Probably too crazy for us to talk about here.
Start talking about doing drawings in blood, you know, so I'm going to cut my finger to do it. I don't want to do that, really. But I've had thought of it, doing blood, actual blood drawings. And, you know, slow.
Don't do too many of them. Just
just a few, yeah. Just so you keep. How many pints have we got? 8 pints, right? Well, I could lose 4 pints of that, you know. 4 bottles. Yeah, I could do it then.
I'll lend you a few if I get a copy. Your art is visceral, unique, powerful, and it has had a massive impact on the world. I mean, you talk in the documentary about art as a weapon. Can you maybe explain what you mean by that?
It is a weapon because I'm throwing it around. I'm using it as such an angry way sometimes that that person that I've drawn is going to hurt. That's how I want it to feel, you know. I've just done Mitt Romney, and you know, they haven't put it in yet. I don't know whether they'll use it. They should do, but there's an asshole, you know, that I couldn't possibly imagine. There's another one, was Sarah Palin. She was another terrible woman, and I'd drawn her as a mad thing, a crazy, you know, something. The only thing of value is the thing you cannot say. But you can draw it. You can't say it in the same way as, you know, a drawing will sort of express it so much better than can do, you know, in the right frame of mind and everything. But it could express it so much more vehemently than if you had to find the correct paragraph to cover it, you know, or chapter, in fact. You know, to say exactly what it was you wanted to say. And it's that that makes it so powerful for me. You know, if I'm going to do anything, I may as well make it a weapon. I may as well make it to be what it wants to be, you know. You know, and so that's why I often start a drawing by just going slap with the page, you know. White sheet of paper, slap. And then see where that's going to go to. Where are those blots going to? I don't know. And it depends. If I'm going to draw somebody, sometimes there's often blots in before the drawing is done. See, I cheat. You know, you didn't know that. Yeah, you've got to become a cheat. You've got to be a cheat. You've got to And I didn't change the world, I realised. Although I said, yes, I did change the world. The world is worse now than it was when I started. That's what really happened.
Your art, much like Hunter's writing, has an incredibly powerful voice, but I'm curious which artists inspired you to find that voice. I mean, you do talk about some of the classic painters.
George Gross was one of my favourites, and Hogarth up to a point. I've even done Hogarth Schmogarth, a series called that, you know, using his, you know, Beer Street. And the difference between Beer Street, the jolliness of Beer Street, and Gin Lane, oh, they were the difference between the two, where the mother with her baby, the baby falling over the steps, you know, and things like that. The sort of terror of that was, I made that quite distinctly vicious, and the Beer Street one as jolly as I possibly could make it, you know. So it was just follow. You're telling stories in limited spaces, in a way, you know. Well, it can be quite a big... My pages got bigger and bigger until they got to be the imperial size, the old imperial size, which now is A1. And that's the size I draw on. Whatever the drawing is, whatever it is, it doesn't matter if it's going to be a little thing or a bit of writing on the page. I use A1 and that's it. I don't cut it in half, or it's pointless. I mean, I'm just using paper, you know. A waster. That's what I am. A waster.
The magnificent Johnny Depp, who of course was a big part of this documentary.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the special connection between him and Hunter and the process of making this film with him there helping you?
Well, he was there in the kitchen in Owl Farm back in the 90s, before, because I get kind of mixed up with this fact that we're now in another century, you know. He was around a lot, that's when I met him, you know. It was just like, you could be a buddy, we're just a friend of Hunter's, really. And he was one, and I was one, and he realised I was doing the drawings for Hunter, and we have a few pictures of ourselves, you know, high, you know, in old Bali. And it was so nice when he was coming to England, and they were Tim Burton to make a film about the last thing. I think it was the Dracula one. He came and he wanted to come down and visit. And I thought, wow, that's terrific. And of course, it got round, you know, Johnny Depp's in Maidstone. it was the effect it had on people, but it's just ridiculous. We had a helicopter looking at us, my wife Anna and myself, in pyjamas, standing, looking out the window at a helicopter, which is quite ridiculous, really. You know, but that's the thing about... I mean, he has become an especially big star. I mean, you know, he really is a kind of enormous character. I mean, I think anything he made, if you gave him, you know, encyclopedia to read or something, he'd make it interesting somehow. I don't know. He's just that interesting. Because I remember seeing the first film of his, you know, what's the name? There were two of them, actually. Edward Scissorhands was one of them. And then there was another one. Edward, yeah. Yeah, that's it. Oh, memory's coming back. Yeah. And I think that they were quite unusual films. But I don't think that Tim Burton had come along then to really gel this monolith, this ball of rather neat energy, you know, that he is, you know, and he's someone that can... I just got a bit fed up with it, I'm sure he wouldn't mind if I said I'm a bit fed up with his Treasure Island type things. Pirates of the Caribbean, you know. But I couldn't watch them, you know, they weren't for me. It's funny that I must teach him how to dress properly. You know, he's not the best of dressers for that kind of thing. He could be. He's got my hat, by the way. I got a black hat that I think it's in the film, I don't know, somewhere. He's got a black hat with a bit of stuff around it.
One of the most powerful moments in the documentary, a very moving scene, is where you and Johnny are discussing losing Hunter and how that's affected both of you. I guess, I mean, you had such a complicated and passionate friendship. How do you feel now about him not being here?
A tragedy. Absolutely the big tragedy, you know, the big one. It was my friend Joe Petro the Third from Louisville, Kentucky, you know, who rang me up and said, take your phone off the hook, Ralph. Hunter's committed suicide. That was February 20th, 2005. And it's been an empty hole, a huge empty hole, really. I'm doing a book on extinct birds, and that's done. And that's coming out too. But that, you know, and I've started doing other creatures for no good reason, you know. Isn't that the name of this film? And dogs and cats and all sorts of things like that. Yeah, after landladies, dogs and cats. And do you know, the book on landladies never got done. That would have been a great film, wouldn't it? Catching the landlady in the toilet, you know, somehow. For no good reason. But there we go. And I don't know whether it was a mistake not to do landladies, or was it quite a good move not to do them and do dogs instead, because I hated dogs at the time. But then I got a lovely dog called Flop. And we called her Flop because she used to herd up sheep that were in the paddock, about 20 or 30 of them. And I noticed something about that which I'd never known before, that sheepdogs herd just like wolves in packs of nine. That's what they're doing. They're covering a sheep, you know, a herd of sheep, in 9 points around a circle. It's an interesting little fact, you know. And I bet a lot of people don't know that, actually.
They do now. One of the books that people most readily associate you with is Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
I mean, clearly it's a classic work of literature, but your images seem to have propelled it to a slightly different level. What do you think? Can you talk a little bit about the experience of working on that specific book and what you think your work brought to it?
Well, only that he chose not to take me on the story. He took a Samoan lawyer in case he got into trouble and he needed someone. A wise move it was. You're no good, Ralph. You wouldn't stand up on any of this. I mean, if you get any real trouble, you can't do anything. You wouldn't be able to. Forget it. You know, it's just... I'm sorry, Ralph, but if you don't mind doing the drawings, that'll be fine. You know.
Straight you and deport you at once.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. I mean, you know, doing all those things... oh, God. Some of the things that we thought about doing, I would have been finished in America and never been able to go back. But luckily didn't do some of the things we talked about doing. Like writing on the boats and things like that, you know. It was a madness that gripped us both for a while, and quite a while actually, since 1970. That's quite a long time actually, up to 2008, 2005. And I don't know where the time's gone, and I think someone has stolen 20 years of my life.
You know, Hunter has this iconic kind of mythological status as someone who was crazy and pushed boundaries. But in a way, I think one of the things that the documentary obviously deals with is the fact that you were just as crazy. And in some respects, in terms of the chances that you took with your work, particularly when it came to attacking America, you've been perhaps even braver than Hunter was at times.
Well, he loved America. He's an old-fashioned Southern gentleman, really. And he had no right to consider himself, you know, the creator of Gonzo. I think we did, it was the meeting that gelled it, you know, between us and made things happen for us both, in a way. And we'd bounce off each other. But he'd say to me, you know, take that filthy gibberish off of here. You know, that's gibberish. Everything I did was gibberish, you see. And yet he seemed to love it, you know. And there's Edward, the bird in the cage, you know. Edward, I'm coming to get you, Edward. I'm going to kill you, Edward. I felt
there's
like
no
Edward.
What?
<There's> no... Yeah. I wanted to do something when I did the book on Leonardo. I wanted to do the book of these three things that Leonardo da Vinci had done. The one was to paint the Last Supper on the bedroom wall, which I did. And another one was to build a flying machine, which I did. It wasn't too good flying, but it was... Well, it was a glider-type thing, you know, but I was an aeromodeler back in my youth, you know, my teens. And I guess I wanted to fill my life with lots of things to do, make. I like making things, I like doing things. And I ended up working in a place like Woolworths. Dear old Woolworths is gone, which is a shame. Charlie Paul came along and picked up the idea of doing a film of my life. And I don't know what drove him to do it, but he wanted to do it, and he kept coming back once a month or so, once a week sometimes, and gradually a whole load of stuff has... I mean, I think there's more stuff left out of the film than there is put in it, actually. If you've got to get it down to 100 and, you know, 1.5, 30 minutes, that's only half, there's more of it, you know.
What are you hoping that fans, people who love your work all around the world, are going to take away specifically from this film and this new side of you that they're going to see?
It's a little personal, so you know, they may be surprised at how sweet I am, how nice, how pleasant. It's just exactly as I wanted to be shown. You know, it's all lies, but I like it like that, you know.
How is someone so nice capable of such angry and furious artwork?
I keep asking myself that. It makes me angry to think, you know. No, the world's become a mess. It really has. And I've just been trying to do a little to change it, you know. And I think if I were really to draw Mitt Romney and Sarah Palin and all those sort of people who've come since, and the idea of that Mitt Romney taking over from Obama, who just about passes as a decent enough man, you know, human being, these other people are just ghastly. They are beyond description in a way. If they weren't there, you couldn't invent them. They're so bloody stupid, you know. That's how I feel about them. And maybe I've got to do some drawings to put them right. Maybe I could start doing a series of drawings, ideally inventing my own politicians, who are really what would be really exciting, you know, like action men of some sort, that really do something to change the world for the better or for the worse. It doesn't really matter, but it just means changing it, I think, for the sake of it.
Which piece of work, if there is one in particular, are you most proud of, do you feel is the best legacy of Gonzo and you personally?
I think I like The Curse of Lono, actually. You know, that's my best. That was my title. Hunter had come up with the Hawaiian Diaries, and which is a terrible title, Hawaiian Diaries. It's a bit sort of portentous, you know. So I think the best is The Curse of Lono, and it's got the right work and it's got feeling about it, about the various trips in Hawaii. I mean, what's odd about it, there are seven islands in Hawaii, and I've been coming across them all the time, doing a book on extinct birds. And knowing, oh God, I know that place, I know that, you know. And these birds have been extincted, you know, shot, because that's what people do. My friend Kerry Levy, who did the book on the birds, and he wanted me to do drawings, and I did 136 at least of them, the different extinct birds, which is a book now, and I started inventing birds that didn't exist, you know. So it was a moment of revelation to me, that in a funny sort of way, you get an idea, or somebody asks you to do something, and you can't leave it there. You've got to do more than you're asked for, you know. Like, I don't know, like I was asked to draw Danny Boyle, you know, and I suddenly started for the Olympics, you know. And then I suddenly started getting ideas about doing a whole book about Olympians, you know, and I don't like Olympics much. I'm not very interested in it. But it's kind of interesting to think of what it could become. I was fascinated by the Paralympics, but I don't know whether I would be able to do a whole book of them. Who knows? I think for the moment, for no good reason, is the best way to do anything, really. And that's what that's how this film got the title. You know, for no good reason. I mean, it didn't seem like a good one at the time, and it turned into one. And here we are now, sitting in a library, a light in my face, third degree, and all I can do is smile back, you know.
Do you have a message for fans watching this all around the world? Is there anything you'd like to say to them directly?
Keep it going. Just keep it going. Don't give up. It's no good. If somebody tells you you're not doing it right, tell them bullshit. You're doing it okay, you know, whoever you are. It's the best way to think. What's the point otherwise of starting if you're not going to fulfill something? Go out of your way to fulfill something. There's a load of art students out there. They don't know what to do, maybe. I don't know. Well, start something like a weird tick of some sort. You get a peculiar itch, and that itch becomes an idea. And the idea turns itself into something that wouldn't have been there before. And so, I don't know. I feel sorry for people who are sort of starting out in a way, but I envy them as well. I think that's what I'm really trying to say, is I envy the ones starting out now with all that in front of them to do something interesting. And whatever they do is theirs, not mine.